Ago, and I went on vacation with my family, and what we did is we went on one of those like really big boats, but not like a cruise, but like not like a sailboat. And we went out into the Gulf of Mexico, and it was a really stormy and windy day, and the waves were blowing really high, and wind was everywhere, and so I was getting like very, very seasick, and so I was like, had my hands like gripping the rail, you know, like when your knuckles turn white because you're just so nervous. And I was nervous and I was freaking out. You know when you're nervous freaking out, you have that like pit in the bottom of your stomach and it like won't go away because of how much you just don't know what's gonna happen. And in that moment, I had to trust that the boat was going to stay upright. Because if I didn't trust that the boat was gonna stay upright, then I would have lost my mind and had a breakdown and that would have been good for no one. So I had to trust that the boat was going to be okay. So today, what I want to talk to you about is a story from the Bible, where we learn what faith and trust is from Jesus. And so we're going to start in Matthew 14:22. And it says this: "Immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on the mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves, So I'm going to tell you about Jesus at this time that this story is taking place. What we know about Jesus is that he was super, super famous. Everyone wanted to see him. Imagine in September when Harry Styles was in Austin for Love on Tour, and for six nights in a row he sold out the Moody Center, and people were like camping outside because, oh my gosh, it's Harry Styles and I have to see him. And it was a really good concert. Like, he deserved that. But more than Harry Styles and Love on Tour, imagine if Taylor Swift was about to go on tour, and she is. She's going to Eras Tour. Pre-order your tickets November 15th. Make sure you're there. So Taylor Swift's going on tour, but instead of having to pay $500 for a ticket, you get to go for free. And not only do you get to go for free, you get to get Taylor Swift's autograph, you get to take a picture with her, and it's incredible. Imagine the crowds that would be there at this concert. It would be insane. It would be a madhouse. That's about how famous Jesus was at this time. He constantly had crowds around him, some people for good reasons, some people for bad reasons. Back in those days, there was an incurable disease called leprosy, and if you had leprosy, you were basically condemned to die. You just kind of got kicked out of your city, and you had to go live alone. But people with this disease would come up to Jesus, and then they'd be going home to their family that night completely healed. People were carried to Jesus up on a stretcher because they were paralyzed and they couldn't walk. And then they walked home to their family that night because Jesus healed them. These are the kind of miracles that Jesus is pulling off. And because he's doing these incredible things, people didn't leave him alone. He was like the celebrity of today. People were always around, always wanting to be with him. And so he was exhausted. And so the story's taking place. He just preached for a lot of days in a row. That night he fed 5,000 people with a few loaves of bread and a few fish. And he was tired. And so he sent everyone away. He sent the crowds, like, go home to your families, leave me alone. He sent his friends, disciples, he sent them away on a boat. They went out on a boat, and he was like, talk to y'all later, we'll figure it out, it happens later. And he just went, and he rested, and he prayed, and he spent time alone. And so he did this for a while, and he's like, okay, I've rested, I've prayed, it's time for me to go get back to my friends. And so he walks down to the lake. Like I said, his disciples are out on a boat in the middle of the lake. It's not like today, where if you're going tubing or wake surfing with your friends, you just walk down to the dock and you're like, hey, I'm here, come pick me up, and you give him a call. He couldn't like hop on a jet ski or anything and go meet him. He was just alone on the side of this lake. But he's Jesus, and he's done incredible things. We're about to see him do another one. It says, shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. It's a ghost, they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, it is I, don't be afraid. Okay, so first of all, whoa, Jesus is walking on water, which is insane, because people can't walk on water, you sink in water. Also keep in mind how we talked about the wind buffeting the waves. So the boat was shaking, everything in the water was like huge waves coming up. It also says it's dawn, and so the saying goes darkest before dawn, so it's basically pitch black, the moon's gone down, the sun hasn't come up yet, and then all of a sudden, the disciples, who are sleep-deprived and tired, because you can't really sleep on a boat that's rocking back and forth all night, one of them looks up, and he sees something walking towards him. And I'm sure he was tired and sleep deprived, so he kind of like rubs his eyes a little bit. And he's like, am I seeing what I think I'm seeing? And then he like taps his friend on the shoulder. And he's like, hey, tell me I'm not crazy. There's something walking towards us, right? I'm sure his friend like looks up and then just starts screaming because we just got past Halloween. Like this has to be out before me because something is just walking through the water towards you. Think about times in your life when you've been scared. Maybe it's like before the first time you went on a roller coaster that went upside down, or before you went in a haunted house, or maybe the time when you've been home alone or late at night and you hear like a banging sound downstairs. You know that feeling you talk about, the pit in your stomach? If someone just turns to you and is like, hey, don't be afraid, it's not going to make you not be afraid, or is that going to help at all? No! And so this ghost that's walking towards him is like, don't be afraid. And I'm sure they just scream their head off until eventually the waves kind of cleared, the sea blew in, and they're like, oh, it is Jesus. We actually don't have to be afraid. It's kind of crazy, but we'll be okay. And so we keep reading after the disciples have gathered their thoughts and kind of calmed down. And the Bible says this, Lord, if it's you, Peter replied. Peter's one of the disciples. Tell me to come out on the water. Come, he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came towards Jesus. So here's where I want to get. This is an example of faith. Faith beyond anything we could ever see. In eighth grade, we learned the definition of faith this year. Faith is not just believing something, but faith is being able to trust in something. Peter, the guy who just asked Jesus to walk out with him, he knew that Jesus was the Son of God. He knew that he came down to earth to save us, and he was going to do all these incredible things. But could he trust in that in this moment? It's very, very difficult to move knowledge from your head into your heart, from knowing it to truly trust it. There's a lot of things in my life that I feel that way about. But Peter trusted God in this moment, and he stepped out of the boat onto water. How many of y'all, when you were a little younger, tried to run across a pool or run across a lake? Did you do that? How's it go? Does your foot hit anything? Do you get even like one step, or do you just sink straight to the bottom? You just sink straight to the bottom. So that's what Peter was risking when he stepped out of this boat. He could have just sunk straight down. But did that happen? No, because he trusted Jesus, because he had his eyes on Jesus, he stepped on what was like solid ground, and he was able to walk out towards Jesus, and then he walked all the way to Jesus, and they celebrated together, and it was awesome. No, that's not what happened. So, we keep reading, and it says, but when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, cried out, Lord, save me. Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. You of little faith, he said, why did you doubt? And then they climbed into the boat, and the wind died. Peter saw the wind, and he saw the waves, and he took off his eyes of Jesus, and he started drowning. I just asked you if you tried to run on water, but how many of you have jumped out of a boat, like into a lake or a river or something like that? Do you, like, sink slowly, like you're in quicksand, or as soon as you hit the water, you just, like, sink like a rock? You just sink, because you're not, like, treading water or have a life vest on, you just sink. And so that's what happens to Peter. He takes his eyes off of Jesus, he starts to go down, and he probably only has like a second to be like, before he just starts going straight down. That's Peter losing his trust in Jesus. What are things in our life that can cause us to lose our trust in Jesus or take our eyes off of Jesus? I can think of a few things like this in my life, things that have made me take my eyes off of Jesus. Maybe for you, it's watching the news and seeing natural disasters or hurricanes or tornadoes, things that we've seen lately destroy people's houses. Maybe it's someone in your family or someone close to you getting sick and having a disease that we don't know how to cure. Maybe it's parents separating. Maybe it's just scrolling through social media and seeing all kinds of hard, difficult things and being like, God's in control. What's happening? How does this thing happen? We can also be distracted, like Peter, by the things of this world, things that make us take our eyes off of God. I know for me, there's times where I know I need to spend time with Jesus, and then I've been scrolling on TikTok for 3 hours, and then I finish scrolling on TikTok, and I'm like, too late to do anything now. Or for y'all, I know we just finished, if you play sports, volleyball and football season. It goes from August until November, and then there's one day off, and then you start basketball. And how can I be the best athlete I can? And how can I make the top team? And how can I do all these things? And that wraps up your mind. Or you get home from practice, or you get home from school, and there's tests, and there's projects, and there's quizzes. And you have to keep your mind on all these things. And then the next thing you know, you haven't thought about Jesus, you haven't thought about faith or anything in 3 weeks because you have other things to do. When I was young, things would happen to me all the time. There's nothing I could do to keep that from happening. And whether we lack trust because of hard things or we lack trust because we simply get distracted, Jesus has the same question for us all. You have little faith, why did you doubt? I just gave examples of why we doubt and get distracted. Why should we not? That's a hard question, and it's a question that I have had a really hard time figuring out the answer to over the last 2 years. And the answer that I've kind of come up with for myself is why I should have trust and why I should have faith is hope. I have hope that whatever Jesus has coming for me is better than what I left behind. I have hope that Jesus is working all things for my benefit, whether I realize it or not. And I know the world we live in is broken and full of sin, and we go through hard times a lot. But I have hope that Jesus is bigger than that. I have hope that he is making a plan for the future, for eternity, something that I don't understand. When I think of hope, I think of something called a controlled burn. Has anyone here heard of a controlled burn? What that is? So a controlled burn is they go out into nature, wilderness, like a field or a forest, or maybe a drought has killed all the grass, or storms come through, and it's knocked all these trees over, and so there's shade, and things aren't able to grow anymore, nothing can come up through the ground because it's too dry, or it's not getting the sun it needs. This part of nature that's too overgrown, too many weeds, things can't grow, that represents us. That represents us when we're distracted by the things of the world, when we care too much about trying to be cool, to keep our eyes on God, we fall into temptation, cheating, saying things we're not supposed to say, and we let the things of the world distract us rather than focus on God. So when nature is like this, what they do is they just go and they light it all on fire. They blow torches and matches and everything, and they just burn it all to the ground until there's nothing left but ashes. What was this big field or this big forest, there's nothing left. And it stays like that for a little bit, but don't stay like that forever. Eventually, new life starts to grow up. Grass starts to grow again. Trees start to grow again. Nature comes back. So yes, we get distracted, and yes, this world feels hard. We take our eyes off of Jesus, but at least let's grow. We're able to grow through that. When Jesus and Peter got back in the boat, the Bible says this. Then those who were in the boat worshipped and sang, "Truly, you are the Son of God." So they went from just believing that Jesus was the Son of God to trusting him. They knew Jesus was the Son of God. They knew he could do all these things. But they hadn't experienced it firsthand, like when Peter stepped off the boat. When we experience it firsthand, we realize that Jesus is going to do incredible things in our life. All we have to do is turn to him and put our eyes on him and trust him. I'm going to pray, and then the first prayer is going to sing another song. All right. Jesus, thank you for this day again.